Okay, I hope people are joined now. We will start from the last class where we left. So, couple of things we did was writing a first character device driver and registering it on the VFS layer as a file, making a node of it, and try performing operation on our own device driver. So, in this particular architecture, I would like to take you to a bit of architectural overview, how actually kernel does that. So that is very critical in every sense, because once you start writing your own device driver, or maybe you are working on a device driver which is somebody's device driver, like you have Veritas device driver for dynamic multipathing, how it attaches into the kernel and how it functions. So this basic concept is very much critical, because it will help you to identify and understand the internal architecture of the softwares. So first thing is kernel framework, how kernel basically accommodate device driver, what is the protocol of doing it, what you need to do, how you will register, and what the things are required, and what actually happens inside the kernel. So we will start. I'll sh start sharing the screen now. Okay, so last exercise, who has been able to do the exercise? Who did that? Anybody tried writing ioctl call? Jitu? Okay, so do you have any screen or anything which you can share to us? Okay, you share something, I will see. Present it to everyone so that. Okay. Make your window a bit smaller, and keep the middle of it. Okay. Okay, till the time Jitu comes up with that, I will take you back to the yesterday's so. In this particular scenario where we have written very minimal character driver, okay, so what exactly you do a character device register, right? So you need to understand each and every call, what is what you need to do and what it requires. So character dev, here you are giving major number, you are giving device name, and you are giving file operations structure. Okay, what is that? So basically, kernel asks two, three things. Okay, what is your reserved major number for that? Device name is something like our device name was care dev. You can give your own device name, which device driver name, whatever you want to give. And then you give fops. Fops is basically a character, not computer science character. The character is the original character. What is the character of this device? What is the read function? What will happen when you read to this device? What is the write function? What is So basically, you are trying to register your own software inside kernel space, and that will have its own characteristic, right? What will happen to read, what will happen when you write. So you have seen the FOPS here, this one. It is defined in fs.h. So what you do, you define your own read calls. So this is the functions: device read, device write, device open, device release. Now this is exactly same. You do open, when you say a open call, a device open will be called. When you say read call to your file descriptor of the open device, this function will be called. When you say write call, this will happen. When you call close to that file, this function will be called. So these all functions are defined by us in our own kernel module. Okay, so every device driver, whatever is written till now, have followed the same way of doing things. So they register their device to VFS layer. VFS layer will have the FOPS handle. FOPS handle will have all the information about the what function need to call when somebody open reads write to the device. So there is a list of FOPS which I have given you. There is a huge list of function calls, right? What could be the possibilities? So this FOPS is required to register your device. Once you have all this in place, so here in this case, in our character device, we have only four operations supported in our device driver, right? So our character device driver only supports these four calls, and these four calls and rest of the calls we haven't initialized. So in C99 compiler, this is the way of actually assigning the function pointers rather than giving the I'll show you one link where we used to do in older kernels. Older compiler was not that much smart. So what we used to do is, Okay, this is the way we have used. The previous old way was, if I will get any source code, I can show you. Yeah, this is the way. So what you have done is you have declared a structure, right? You have actually defined one of the object of this particular structure type, and you have initialized the variables of that structure at the time of declaring it. So null means this was particularly for seek operation, so it is not supported in our device. We have given null. We have given device read, device write, read dir, we have given null, we have given null. So these all the function pointers, read dir, select, seek, will get the null null pointer, and basically will not go anywhere, will return. And these device read, device write, device ioctl, and device open are the four functions, and device release, these five functions will work only, and rest of the things will not work, like select, read dir, mmap, these kind of things will not work. So basically this is how was the previous way of doing it, but in the latest compilers and all, you can give it like this. So you don't need to give null, and you don't need to care about the order of the variables in which you need to assign it to function pointers. What you will do, you will define, okay, for this particular function pointer I want to initialize it with this, for this particular function pointer I want to initialize with device write. So this is how it is architected. And I want you to show me some of the work which you have done till now, because from here it is going to be a bit of more critical. Okay, so this is very basic thing and you need to do it. Okay, give me a second, guys. You share your screens. Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, Karthik, did you do any work on the assignments? Rama? Yeah.
So yeah, what you know what I did was that adding the Thick string to the kernel version that I did, and then kernel module compilation, and then using that module to finding the what this information about the module loading unloading, and like the last class I missed out, but today morning I watched the video last class. So like I will complete that parameter more assignment, like mod params you said, and then I have those two things are pending for myself.
Okay.
One more thing, stackable file system in the process I sent out that actually I think I'm not able to find that option to make new. Later someone asked a question. That is one part I didn't do, like what is the approach to
Okay, so there is one thing. You can find some of the kernels which has the support for stackable file system. I think latest Ubuntu version has that one. G2 did it, and what and how you can do it is you can get the latest RapFS and you try compiling it. If your kernel supports a stackable file system, you could be able to load that module. If it doesn't, then you wouldn't be able to compile your RapFS file system. Another thing is, if your kernel doesn't have that capability to support the stackable file system, then you need to patch your kernel. The patching means there will be some changes which you need to sink in. So kernel by default. Yeah, it has to. Okay.
Like I mean,
Four point three. Yeah. So I mean, you can see it here, right? If you okay, let me open it. this is important paper. Can go through it. Yeah, I shared it on chat window. And are you able to see my screen, right?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. There is one kernel which is already has support. You can git clone that one. This 3.17 kernel, you can find it in Nectec Labs repo. You can run a command git clone and this link, it will get the kernel for you. So this is the link. Compile this kernel.
Okay.
You will be able to see this stackable file system support also.
Already I downloaded 3.17 from kernel.org.
Okay.
That should also have, right?
No.
So that
will
not.
Okay. That will not. That you need to patch with the changes for the support.
Okay, fine. Let me download and
see. Yeah. So it will. You need to run this. You have to do git clone for this.
What is stackable file system?
So stackable file system is basically previously what is the architecture, right? You fire some system calls and some of the file operations on VFS layer. Okay, so VFS layer identifies this file, this inode or file which belongs to which file system. So underlying file system, let's say it is NFS, it is ext2 or ext3. Now what a stackable file system tells that you can actually write your own software, your own file system, and you can intercept in between the file system layers. So if you see that previously virtual file system was directly talking to NFS, now it is talking to ecryptfs. So there was a documentation written by Nectec interns a bit back. So I think there is some diagram which shows that. So here you can see a file system replicator, and here is the, I think you can find the documentation somewhere also. Okay, so this is the basic architecture, right? Previously the VFS layer used to talk to different file system, NFS, ext2 directly by its own. Now the wrapfs comes in between. So you can understand the stackable file system is something like this. Previously if you see the application interface from kernel, all the applications usually do this read, write, and all these operations, right? So they fire. So these all are the basically system call from the applications which are coming, and basically what you do, okay, so these all are the application calls as a system call to the application interface from the kernel. It comes to VFS. VFS actually, what it used to do, it used to call the FOPS for the particular file system, and whatever the read write functionality to the underlying file system, it used to call. Okay, now what happens with the case of a stackable file system is it can. So basically, FOPS is multiple objects which is defined inside your file system, right? So not in the case of these two are different. This is these two are file system. So
my question is like at a time, it will be all the one file system.
No, no, no. That. Multiple you can have. Okay, so your slash home could be with the formatted with the file system ext2. Your slash var would be mounting a file system of ext3. Okay, so your you may have a different file system, which you can see it here. If I run a mount command, right? In mount command, you can see then that this device devsts6 is mounted on slash location, and its type of file system is ext4. Okay, and if you see this one slash dev sda2, this is the device which is mounted on this location, media pankaj and some number, and it is mounted as a fuse block. The type of file system is fuse block. So fuse block is your user land file system driver, which is used to mount your NTFS partition. So and you can have multiple. If you have, let's say I will have another hard drive with formatted with the ext3 file system, and I mounted it on slash home, I could be able to see it below this, right? Similar kind of entry. So you can have multiple file system, and how kernel does this is the way. So your any read or write call, your same application is actually writing on irrespective of the file system, right?
Yeah.
We user or application never care what is the file system they are writing. They just open a file, read it and write it and close it. Now it is a file system, and it's a layering how it does it. That's it. This VFS will get the read request, and this read request, it will call the read of ext3, and if it gets a read request on the ext2 file system, it will call the read of that ext2. So there only this fsops come into the picture. So fops I explained in last class. You can go through the video, you can probably can just, you know.
Yeah, I seen that there is a lc handler could be there for read, write.
Yeah, so you can have okay, let me where is that? So once you start that, right, you can see in the cscope file underscore operation. So file underscore operation, you define it here in your own driver. This is a file system driver.
system driver.
So you define it
You
here.
define it here.
Oh, my voice is echoing, I think. No? Okay. Let me show you that file operations structure that you always needs to initialize whenever you attach any of the file system or any of the device file. So okay, let me show that to you. Okay, so file operation. Okay, if you see this is the file operations. Sorry, it's not file operation, it's file operations. It is defined, just find it there. So use C scopes to search the symbols in your kernel source code. It is a simple tool which has how to find a C symbol, how to find global definition and all. So now you need a definition on fs.h. So I'll go there. So these are the possible operations on any file you can do. So what we did here, when we have written code for character driver, right? We initialize read, write, open, release, and unlock ioctl. Okay. So this is your read function pointer. So there we use function pointer actually. So read, write, now unlock ioctl, this one. Open is another function pointer, and release. Yeah. Big kernel lock. Yeah. Yeah. No, the difference was this unlocked ioctl and previous ioctl. The difference is previous ioctl usually take a big kernel lock. That means once the ioctl inside the kernel mode right now, it will not allow another ioctl to come into that. Okay, so that big kernel lock is actually not acceptable because you want to protect the data, so you need to handle your locking inside your driver itself rather than locking the whole driver, right? So let's say my five six applications may want to use your device driver, and your device driver is continuously busy on taking the big kernel lock. It's a bit bottleneck. So they have came up with the solution of providing unlock IOCTL. Unlock IOCTL makes you enter into the kernel space. Now inside the data, wherever the critical section is, you need to handle the locking, right? So you will have multiple threads inside. Now your driver need to have a locking mechanism to protect the data. The compact IOCTL is introduced for your 64-bit to 32-bit support. So what is there is you have 64-bit kernel and you are running 32-bit application about. So 32-bit call happens, and how it will actually manage the data, align it according to the 64-bit kernel. So this all comes under the category of compact IOCTL. So you have any 32-bit applications already which will be used by your device, and your device is compiled with 64-bit, you put them in the category of compact IOCTLs. So IOCTLs, I think you might have seen that the architecture that you give, you open a device file and you give the file descriptor, then it takes one basically a flag which will define the type of operation you want to do with the device, and then integer, so that will again a number. So you can see any of the IOCTL call. What I will suggest that until you write one single IOCTL, you probably will not be able to understand the difference. It completely signifies what is in user space and what is in kernel space. So looking at a device driver, right, why and how it is happening inside kernel is the more important. And once you have that idea, probably you can crack it down to any of the device drivers. You will have the approach of understanding it. So and the questions in the kernel sites are very open. I would say it's a vast, very vast thing. No one can know everything around the kernel, but a right approach will make knowing anything around it. So it depends. Whatever the area you will choose to work, but the original architecture will remain same. So IOCTLs, if anyone completed, Karthik, did you try doing IOCTL work? Jitu, you have IOCTL, did you try it? Okay, I think Jitu's connection is lost. Anyways, Karthik, you there? Okay, anyways, I'll Karthik. Are you able to hear? Okay, so what we'll see it here, basically my question was, anybody can anybody explain, if I do a open call to a device or open call to a normal file, a device file or a normal file, what is the difference in these two things? Can anybody explain, I mean, what was the difference? Yeah. Yeah. True. So, I mean, this is the actual difference. Actually, what happens when you do it to a file? When you do it to a file, you have a layer called file system. So, what it does when you do any read or write to a file, here it comes to these two file systems, right? And these file system are basically. So if I take this file system. This will go. To the respective drivers, right? So, you may have. Right. So okay, like this VFS layer, right? You will have a similar kind of layer here, which is called generic block layer, and this generic block layer will have all the IO information, the physical IO which need to be done, and below that it will be routed back to the appropriate device driver. So this is not VFS, this is generic block layer. Okay. And these two yeah, it could be because your SDO device is same, but you have different partitions. Right, and every partition can be formatted with different file system. So you could have ext3, ext4, you can have JFS, you can have Mac file system also. So it depends, I mean, which file system you have formatted your drive. And so I have formatted, let's say this is kind of okay, I need to pull it up. Okay, now you can see that this particular call, which is fops is called for ext2, all the writes which came into the generic block layer is actually redirected to the driver. So this driver may be is a SCSI driver, is a it could be it depends on which kind of, you know, the real hardware you have. So let's say it's a driver 1, and this is another ATA device which is driver 2. Okay, so this is how it done. But in case of your in case of your own character device or making a device device call, if you open a device file and do a device if you open a device and do a read write or anything to the device, it comes up here, it comes to the driver directly, right? So these layers comes into the picture when you do a normal these layers come into the picture when you do a write to the normal normal file, and this these layers will not come into the picture when you do that. So basically your fops is defined in your each of the driver, which makes it represented as a file inside /dev. So inside /dev, you will see all the devices. Supported as a file, and you can see the type of the devices also. So you register any device to the kernel has to be exported as a device file here, right? It has to give the fops also, and you can see in the code. So everyone has to have their own definition of read writes and open read write and all these things. So you see the device of our caradev.c. Here we have given the fops, and fops is passed in the call register caradev. So register caradev will have one major number, device name, and the fops. So fops, it will put a hook into the kernel. Then whenever you trigger open to this particular device file, it will call these functions, which is initialized by your own fops. So you do call open, VFS will trigger a open to device open. So every mount location, basically not every mount location, every registered file system will have its own fops, and every mount entry of that particular file system is will be calling those fops of the file system. So you can mount one file system in multiple locations. You may have multiple devices formatted with the file system. So that is there. So basic architecture we need to understand is that VFS gives you the homogeneous view of a file system, which is irrespective of the underlying implementation of that. So your devices exported as a file is user can just see the device as a file. They can trigger a open, read, write, close, and do many more operations. And IOCTLs are another FOPS file operation, which will give you a special privileges. Let's say what IOCTL can do. Let's say my device is having a bandwidth limit of 400 kbps, and if I want to allocate some of the bandwidth to some special application, so I can definitely have that kind of IOCTL which will schedule the more writes from this particular application, and schedule rest of the bandwidth will be given to another application. So you can have multiple ways. You can actually configure, get or set values inside your own driver through IOCTLs. So your IOCTL class is very critical. You need to write one IOCTL at least to understand where and what need to be changed. If you have any questions, you ask it here. Later on, we will have more to come in the file system side, and maybe in the locking and interrupt side. But this concept has to be clear in the mind. This is very, very critical. And not just like not the pictorial one only. It has to be hands-on. Your hands-on has to be strong enough to write a new IOCTL for any of the device. So you need to do this exercise. So Jitu, did you complete IOCTL? Can
sir, right now there is a problem. I will send you mail after the class.
Okay. Okay. You have any Git repo?
Yeah, I have.
Okay, share it.
Right now, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, I'll do later after the class.
Oh. Okay.
I'll not upload it actually.
Okay. Yeah. We'll take 10 minutes break and come back. Okay. 3:10, 3:20 we'll start again. Yeah.
Sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
Sir, can I upload assignment over the GitHub?
There was
a doubt in my mind actually. If I upload something, there is a problem with it.
Okay. Okay, I'll give you a call. Let's talk there. Here, your voice is so much in disturbance.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So. So let me get some piece of code to write a IOCTL. Maybe we can also enhance it, like what kind of Let's take a example of making a device IOCTL of changing the debug ability of your driver. Okay, so in IOCTL, basically your architecture would be that you pass a number to your IOCTL and it will change the debug levels of your device driver. So let's go to the debug levels first, where we will find it. So kern info, I will go and see where the definition is. Okay. This is kernel debug levels. 0 is system is unusable, which is critical. Kernelity is again critical. Action must be taken. Kernel critic is critical conditions. Some error has happened. Kernel error, if there are any error conditions happened. Kernel warning is you can give warnings. This associate to a number. So whatever the debug number is enabled, you can probably have that debug ability enable your driver. So let's put some of the kern debug. Kern debug is statements. So let's say I have character so what you need to do is you need to go and find out what is the type of this function. So unlock IOCTL. Which is named as device IOCTL in our case. Okay, what could be the best if we write one, or anyone can give a suggestion if you want to write one in front of you, or we have to take a dip to a case study where the real device drivers are there and we can explore them a bit. Karthik? Rama, yeah. Okay. That is cool. So see, IOCTLs are everywhere. You see any device file, any thing inside your slash dev, they must have some IOCTLs associated to it. You see any video drivers, these all are the video drivers, DVD, DMX dev. This is again a video driver. Coda, okay, again a video driver. It's from NVIDIA, I think. Luster. Okay. Okay, so look at this one, right? Driver TTY underscore IO dot C. So it's a if you can see in the source code. Okay, so we'll go to Linux kernel. Inside Linux kernel, there are drivers, there are TTY. Okay, so here you have file TTY underscore IO dot C. This one, right? So inside that, you have TTY IOCTL is the function inside your driver which handles all those IOCTLs for TTY driver. So we'll go into it. We'll see what is written into that. Okay, so TTY IOCTL is defined again in the same file. You can see it here. TTYIO.c 3664 line number, right? Oh, okay. It takes a file pointer, struct file pointer. Then it takes a command. A command is usually a number and a one variable, the arguments to that command. So these are the commands. Commands are, so what it did is, TTY paranoia check is, okay, that we'll look at later on what it does. Okay, is it a real TTY or it is a virtual TTY? Okay, all right. Here we'll check what it does to the commands. So see, every particular command, right? This is the command, and this is potentially a integer value, right? Because you pass this command from IOCTL, it will come down here and it will check the switch case, and if it is if any of these commands any commands are there, it will run these functions, TTY check change, if TTY has been changed, and if it is changed, then it will return from the IOCTL. So these are the error checks what could be possibly done with your driver. And now look at the real thing, what happens to your when you pass a command. So you pass this command, this will call this function. So this function will particular potentially will be doing something. So we will we'll first check what these commands stands for. So if I want to see this particular command, so I can find it in source code. I run I will run grape. Okay, so it is inside. Let me put R here. Okay, must have defined somewhere else. Okay, so IOCTL numbers, right? So these are all IOCTL numbers, and they are using these IOCTL numbers. And this IOCTL numbers are unique in nature because you need to have separate commands for separate operations, and they are using these standard IOCTL numbers for them. If you are writing your own driver for basically having your device might be having your own operations of handling thing, then you might need to configure it according to your own device. So let's say you have a device which where you can actually change the bandwidths. That is one case. Your device have HA capability for some of the applications to serve things. Some of the application may not have privilege to have HA. So that kind of IOCTLs can be can be called for your device to configure. So what you do from your application, let's say I have a device driver and I have command sets, my own command sets which actually change the configuration of the device. So those command lines potentially calling IOCTL for my device to configure it accordingly. So let's say I created my own device for storing files and maybe a file system also and a device driver also, and I have a command called store. Let's say command line is called store data. So store data is my command line which is an application, and it is giving you command lines to configure your device. So it is potentially calling an IOCTL to change the parameters inside device to behave in that way, right? So we'll go back in ttyio.c ttyio.c. Here you can search for this. Okay, so for this it is calling this function. Now every device these are basically a device operations, right? You are firing from your application. So your IOCTLs are taking actions according to your request. So it could be a read-only IOCTL, which will give you some information. This is the one thing. Another thing could be it is a configurable options, which is going to change some parameter in your device driver to behave differently, and it could be either of these two. So you will be calling function for each of the conditions. So any of the condition comes true, it will basically perform an operation and return from this function. So if you pass if your application calls and passes this macro, this particular value, it will come here, it will call this function and return the value. So it is returning integer type, by the way. Yeah, long. So it will return to user space and give the status whether it has been failed or not. So we will take one operation, maybe, which I could be able to explain you. Okay, so set bit IOCXL, right? EXCL. So we will find out set bit, what it is trying, what it is doing, we will find out. Okay, so inside that driver we can search for this. Set bit is a function. Okay, set bit is everywhere. So where is the definition of set bit? This is the definition of set bit. This has to be okay. This is too many places. Okay, so what you can do in this condition, you can see scope here also. Now you can only search for this particular driver also. Set bit, where is set bit? Okay, set bit is a generic call in kernel. So it will actually set a bit on this variable. What it does is it's unsigned long no, it's a 8-bit unsigned integer. And it is left shift by this NBBY. NBBY is 8 bits, so it is setting the 8th. So whatever the I, so I is like if you pass 3 here, so it will, if you pass 3 here, it will have it will have the remainder of 3 divided by 8, percentage 8, and BBY is defined as 8, right? Because 8 bytes, 8 bits per byte, right? So the remainder will be 3, and A will be left shifted by 3. So your value of A will become 3 left shift will be 100, right? So 100 means 4. So this is how, I mean, you can see lot of left shift, right shift, these kind of operations in kernel. And basically it is very critical there, because the shift operation and all the logical operations are less basically it is a binary operation, so it doesn't take much cycle of the CPU. It happens in a single cycle of CPU instruction set. So you can find this kind of thing almost everywhere in kernel, and extensively used these things in basically if you see the network device driver code. So it's a network device driver and network protocol layer. You will find these things in very extensively used inside kernel, because one of the most performing code in the whole kernel, you can see the network protocol layer. They have written it so beautifully. A single instruction, if it costs one single instruction, it may cost 1,000 instruction overhead if your multiple applications are using it. So they write a code in a way that is the most performing way of writing it. So they use mostly all the possible wherever they can use the device, the bit operation thing, they do that. And the thing is, understanding it is not that much difficult. You have to just need to have the macros are there. There are a lot of macros are there. How you translate those macros, that depends. So this is how you need to read in the kernel. Let's take another example, which is probably using the inside call of TTY. So TTYIO.c. We'll go back there. We'll try and find out some real. Okay. Okay, so here you can see again, this looks very interesting here. How they have managed the TTY terminal, right? You may have a terminal which is representing a console of the system, right? So you will have these calls. Right, this is maybe a hung up TTY where you have connected, and it has created a TTY device for you, the connection, and that is potentially a hung up. That is a situation, that would be a situation for the TTY. You need to explore a bit what is the TTY possible thing. If we go into that, we can find out how hung up things work. Okay, so let me tell you, if you see anything in kernel that would be so vast that you can get engaged with a lot of things. So like I found this thing interesting to look into when this particular thing is attached. So TTYIO is a global one. Okay, is this wow. So okay, see this one. This particular file pointer belongs to your TTY device file. FOP is the file operation pointer. And this is your TTY, your IOCTLs, right? Your FOPs. So if it hung up, basically they change the FOP with the TTY hung up, right? So when TTY hung up, basically you will your file op will be pointing to this one. If it is console, if it is not a SSH based or another connection to your system, it will the file op would be your normal file operation. And if you have console, then it will have console FOPs. So see, there are three conditions of TTY. It states which what kind of IOCTLs it would be pointing. So one dynamism is giving a FOPs, and now depending on your terminal, whether this terminal is a console terminal, it would be capable of showing different kind of thing, right? And if it is not a console terminal, it will have a different kind of capability. So that kind of thing you can see in this driver, but we will go and first find out what basically any function is doing inside IOCTL. So IOCTL, you will have multiple things. We will see what is called here. Okay, this guy is called here in this command. So let's find out. Not IR, it has to be R. Okay. So TTYIO.C has the TTY audit has the declaration of that, right? See this line, right? So we'll go to the TTY audit. In TTY audit, you can see what was the function. This one. So go into that function. Okay. That is not the definition. This is another function. Fake input character. Okay, look at this one. This is not the definition of this function, because the function is this TTY audit TIO CSTI TTY audit TIO TSTI. This is not the function we are looking for. This particular function, it is there in TTYIO.C itself, I think. Yeah, here it is. So fake input character, TTY to fake input into, and TTY is the pointer for your terminal, your own TTY structure, and then first let me tell you that TTY is the terminal which is associated to your processes. So if your terminal is killed, basically that means your process should not remain in the system. All the processes and child processes which have that terminal ID, so that terminal associated to that will be killed. So like this particular screen, which is showing the output to us from the system, if we kill this one from here, the processes, the bash process, and every process associated to this terminal will be killed. So this is one of the case. This is how the terminal is actually associated to your display, and here you can see the fake input to T2I device does the necessary locking and input management, right? This function does that. Doesn't honor flow control. Okay, this is a comment. Locking call function takes TDI IDs. The current signal TTY check the safe without locks. Okay, so they have a particular thing here. Okay, we need to look into the kernel source. So so it cannot be possible like explaining, but you need to go in each function and find out what it does. So this function is logging the TTY IOCTI. Okay, this is for logging purpose. Yeah. Yeah, it does. It logs here, and it tells that your IOCTL has called this particular command, and this is the major minor number, and that is the character device. So, if you go into this function, you will see how it is logging. Yeah. So this is basically your description. What are the IOCTL is being called, okay? And major minor number, then data. What is the data need to be output in the log? And this is the size. So okay, it takes the PID number, and this is where it logs. So AB stands for the buffer, audit buffer, correct? The AB has to be given to somebody, right? AB is given to, okay, it has logged it, logged the information through this function. Okay, so here what it does is it just formats the data. So whatever you see in the log, this particular function is actually formatting the information of the current scenario. What is the PID, what is the data, what is the message, PID, UID, session, what is the session ID. So this is all it is getting it here. See here, task PID NR, it gets the task of the particular PID. It will get the UID of that task. It will get session ID of that task. So it will get related information and create a logging format and then hand it over to the log functions. So this is basically it's logging method. Now we will go back to the IOCTL again. Okay, so here it is actually using this for logging. This is for T L disk. Okay, so take one of the IOCTL for you. I mean, I will take you to here. Take one of the IOCTL as a reference, like we have taken this one, right? So take one of the IOCTL for a reference and read it through in a way that you can find. You have to figure out what it is doing. So the best thing is reading the comments of any function. Once you need to understand where and why it is calling. So what you need to do is you need to again and again looking into the function which are getting called from there, and inside those functions you are calling another functions. You go into that and find out what it is trying to do. So it's the semaphore list maximum scheduled timeout. Okay, so it is something like synchronizing something. okay, so here it is. This particular whole function is for locking basically. Here you can see that it's semaphore and it's a timeout. So semaphore for timeout it will possibly it has to read in that timeout thing. Otherwise it may sleep or may not sleep, but might sleep could be a function which allows thread to keep running but waiting for the semaphore to be allowing inside the critical section. And here this particular thing basically is trying to do a locking. So this is used for locking for what? Okay, save buffer. All right, so here this lock is basically for waiting for so your TTY device may allow some set of threads to receive the information. Not all the threads will be allowed to jump in the critical section and start corrupting things. So we are allowing some set of threads to go into it, and then you receive buffer. So you are basically reading the characters which is coming for that IOCTL, and then you dereference. Dereference LD stands for your TTY L disk, right? So TTY L disk structure must be for getting some data. Okay, so L disk ops and TTY struct. So on particular TTY you are doing some operation. So TTY is okay, cool. So TTY has its own set of operations for okay, possibly this TTY would be a bit of, you know, good exploration for you guys. But I would recommend if you feel so much, you know, is not right now you're not prepared for it, don't go with it, because the only way to get into this is you have to find out by your own. And like this, there are a lot of things in kernel which cannot be, you cannot find the classes, you cannot find the things. But this is how basically you can look into the code and understand. So what I'll take up today is you need to basically write one IOCTL to a character device, okay? And that IOCTL may be you define your own debug statements, okay? Maybe defined with the macro. So once you give once you change the debug level of your character driver through an IOCTL, it has to start logging that those information which is required to be thrown in log file. So did you get the question what I have asked you to do?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So you define your own debug level. Let's say debug level 1, 2, 3, 4, and you define if I pass let's say my where is Garrett Dev? Garrett Dev, right? So go into that. It would not be that much. Okay, we don't have that, so we'll create it. So you define, let's say, debug log 1. Then you define debug log 2, debug log 3, debug log 4, debug log 5, right? And you will add this file to caradev.c. Not this one, we'll do this one, caradev.h. Now your device IOCTL file. Where is that function gone? Okay. Okay. So it has to be. Static long our is device IOCTL. We will have as a struct file pointer file, then unsigned integer command, then you have unsigned long arg. Okay, take this variable. Put it like that. Now I can have switch CMD. Case I can put caretdev dot h. Log level is the function which we are going to create. Okay, so it will take CMD. No, not like that. Basically, okay, like this. Yes, something like that. You need to do it for all. Then you need to do this default. So here you can say current crit. Invalid command to device. Now okay, so once you do ioctl call, if it returns -1, that you have passed a invalid command to your ioctl command from application. If it comes here, if CMD is debug log 1, 2, 3, 4, then only it will basically entertain entertain and changing your device. Okay, and for that, I mean, I have given this skeleton code. Basically, what you need to do now is you have to write a set log level function, which will actually initialize one global variable. So take a global variable, something like this log level, name it log level equals to, by default you keep it 0. Okay, and name it for something like log levels assigned to our device driver. Yeah, and that is settable by your IOCTL call. So this is what you need to do. Another thing, this set function call, you need to do something like static, define it here. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. Let's put it here. It is much better place. You need to define integer cmd in command, and then you do here. You can also take a log, right? Because multiple applications who are trying to change this particular variable, the global variable is your set log, right? Log levels, log level equals to command. Okay, that currently it is not, we are not securing this particular log levels for our device driver, but for the case, you need to put it inside critical section that multiple threads should not be able to basically change it. So you need to put locking here. Put a mutex lock. Okay, so this is your basically homework. You probably need to put some error condition also. If command is less than 0, you return it to return -2. Okay, we have hard coded it. Basically in kernel you can see there is no hard coding, we are using everywhere macro. So we can define that things also if we have errors and associated macro to it. So that we need to define in .h, and you can use it here. So command is less than zero is one condition. Another condition would be if it is greater than 5, right? So put it there. Okay, so you have done that. Otherwise it will enable the log level and return 0. So returning 0 is a good thing, basically knowing that the thing you were trying to do worked. So this is a standard basically everywhere in kernel. If function returns 0, that means it worked. It worked well, it doesn't have any error. So you can see if you are setting any of the log levels, if user space is calling this call, it will go here, it will check for the commands here itself. If it is not these either of these values, the default will anyway give the kernel critical error to that invalid command to the device. But still we need to put a lock here, a check here if anything is passed which is there but invalid value. So this is where you need to write ioctl. I am sending this file to you guys, both .h make file and this all file. You guys have to make a debug log levels for this one. So make clean, and I will give you this one. Okay, so here. So I'm sending you this file, and basically I expect you guys to have a look into it once and change the whatever the skeleton I have made it. Just now you need to write these functions so that your device will change the log levels, and you need to write one small program I'll give that one also to you. Where is that? Okay, this I have given. Okay. This test locking thing that you can use it for writing your calling a particular ioctl for that particular device file. So that I am giving it to you. Test dot tar test. Okay. Oh no, it's too many. rm-test.task. Okay. So I'm sending you these two codes. You probably just need to, you know, look around it and okay. So where is the email list? I will update the calendar, that would be better. So here I am attaching these two files. So it is in the documents. This is the one file, cardiff. Then another file is test.tar. Yeah. So test.tar is the application basically, and caradev.tar where I have changed the source, right? It is the only file, right? Let me check. Caradev vi caradev.c. Yeah, this is the one. Okay, so what you need to do is you need to write ioctl which will enable the logging. So your entry point would be your ioctl call, which is device underscore ioctl. Your a dot out, your test tar have a small application program which will open a device file and reading and writing it. There you need to make a ioctl call to your device file first thing. Then you have to inside device driver code, you need to put a locking, if it is possible for you to put a lock there. Go to take the reference of the source code in kernel and find out how to put mutex lock, okay, and put the locking there so that multiple, if I run multiple thread, it will not corrupt your log level data, okay. And you need to set the log level, and then what you need to do, once you set the log level, it has to print logs accordingly. So I mean to say that once you set the log levels, you need to write one function, create a log, okay, and depending on the log level set by your ioctl, your log level variable value, it has to show the log, okay. So we will you do it and you just update me till this Wednesday so that we can proceed on this more, maybe more into the process management, memory management and kernel side. But this is very critical, and once you start doing and completing this ioctl thing, you will have better understanding to the kernel space and user space differences, how to deal with it, how to create devices, and how to write the device drivers later on. So this is critical, And this is very, very critical because you will go anywhere in interview in any of the product development companies. This kind of question is being asked, and this is the only thing they ask. Nobody asks you that that you have you have explored everything in kernel, but overview and this kind of basic concepts to is expected by every kernel programmer. So you give it a try, give it a practice. It will certainly take some time to get a hand into it, but once you hand into it, it will be very usual for you guys. So take a time, spend some time with it, and whatever the skeleton I have given you, try making a source code which can set the log level for your driver. Okay. Any doubts, whatever the assignment I have given you guys?
No, sir.
Okay.
Sir, I have a doubt regarding a generic block layer, which is you have shown.
Oh, no, we will get into that later on. You read whatever you can in that. But that we'll get into it later on, in the later classes.
Pankaj, I'm sorry, today I had some issues at house, so I had to look after that. So I attended only half of your class.
Okay.
Again, in case if I have any questions, I'll come back.
Okay. Yeah, yeah. Karthik, you drop me a mail anytime, okay?
Yeah.
And yeah. I'm continuously recording this session. We'll upload this session to you guys so that you can refer what I was referring to things, okay? And
yeah.
If you get missed to any of the things, just get back to me. I'll help you guys. But this is very critical. I would say very critical concept of the kernel, which will help you to understand anything in kernel, basically.
All right, definitely.
Yeah.
In fact, I'm reading some of the books so that I can understand in a much detailed way, so that I can reference that back. So I'll definitely do that. I'm written a schedule so that follow that schedule and make sure that I come up to your standards and make sure that
No. It will come up with time, Karthik. That's not a problem. It will come up with time because see, I also started somewhere, right? So
yeah.
I know whole learning curve. It's a bit long learning curve, and every kernel programmer actually respect that. So
yeah.
Don't worry. It is you do lot of things for the first time. So whatever I was referring to, if you face any problem, right?
Mm-hmm.
You just turn back and keep asking me. I want anyone coming out of this class to become a kernel programmer for sure. So I am totally looking at that thing. So don't worry. We'll give it more time. We'll give it more time, but I need a complete dedication from you guys. Okay.
Definitely.
Okay guys, I think I'll stop it here today, and there is a lot exercises I have given already, so try to complete that. We will cover it up. We will start the file system and process management thing from next classes. So Jitu, you have any doubt?
No, sir.
Okay. Okay, Karthik.
Yeah, Pankaj. I think I'll look into the recording again. In case I'll go back to that again.
Yeah, yeah.
In case meaning any questions, I'll definitely put forward. I'll write an email to you.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, Karthik. Okay. Yeah. Okay, guys. I'm putting it off now. So we'll see you next week. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay. Bye.
Thanks a lot, Pankaj.
Thank
you. Bye.
Thank you, sir.
Thanks a lot, guys. Bye.